हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम अगेन टू ईपीजी पाठशाला। आई एम डॉक्टर एम एन गुप्ता, एमेरिटस प्रोफेसर एट डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ बायोकेमिकल इंजीनियरिंग एंड बायोटेक्नोलॉजी एट आईआईटी दिल्ली। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक ऑन मॉड्यूल व्हिच इज अ कंटिन्यूएशन ऑफ द लास्ट टू मॉड्यूल्स and hence we are calling it Immunotechnology 3. The paper of course is Immunology. So basically, to reiterate, all immunochemical techniques are based upon recognition of antigen by the antibody. The formation of the immune complex can also be tracked because it activates the complement system. It can also be tracked by labeling antibody by a fluorescent molecule instead of the radio labels and the enzyme labels which we used in the earlier modules. So the objectives of today's module are to understand the various modes in which the complement activation can be used to detect either the antigen or antibody. We'll also learn how the lymphocytes can be characterized by the secretory product which they throw out. We will revisit in a slightly different way and the different context that how the possibility of erythroblastosis fetalis can be detected by Coombs test. We'll also learn a number of techniques which employ fluorescent labels. So the concepts which we'll be covering in today's module are various tests which are based again upon the consequences of immune complex formation. Alternatively, fluorescent labels can be used to track antibody combining with a particular antigen at either molecular or cellular level. The formation of antigen-antibody complex is a specific association. This fact is further exploited in various techniques which are carried out using spectrophotometry, spectrofluorimetry, optical microscopy, electron microscopy, and fluorescence microscopy. So all these techniques in a way differ in visualization method, which is basically used to look at antigen-antibody formation or one or several of its consequences. Complement fixation tests can detect either antigen or antibody. The test antibody is mixed with the antigen and a small amount of active complement is added. The immune complex activates the classical pathway of the complement and fixes the complement. Any residual active complement is detected by the lysis of the antibody coated erythrocytes. If no complement is left, no lysis of RBC will take place. In practice, a quantity of complement is added to this test, which is just enough to lyse the RBC. Hence, even a small amount of test antibody forms the corresponding amount of immune complex and fixes a significant percentage of the complement. Complement fixation can detect antibody at the level of 1 microgram per ml. By using a constant amount of antibody, one can estimate antigen instead in a given sample. Controls with just antigen and antibody alone are very necessary Some anti-serum can fix complement as these may contain some immune complexes. Some antigen can fix complement alone by an alternative pathway for complement activation. Let us see how does the complement fixation test detects antibodies. In the first step, a test anti-serum is titrated in doubling dilutions and a fixed amount of antigen is added to each well or tube. If antibody is present in the test serum, immune complexes will form. In the second step, complement is then added to the mixture. If complexes are present, they will fix complement and consume it. In the final step, indicator cells, that is the red cells or RBCs, together with subagglutinating amount of antibody, that is the erythrocyte antibody, are added to the mixture. If there is any complement remaining, these cells will be lysed. If it was consumed by the immune complexes, they will be insufficient to lyse the red cells. A quantity of complement is used, which is just enough to lyse the indicator cells, if none is consumed by the complexes. The assay is often performed on plastic plates. By using constant amount of antibody and titrations of the antigen, the assay can be applied for testing antigens. Again, it should be emphasized that appropriate controls are most important in this assay because some antibody preparations consume complement without the addition of antigen. For example, as we pointed out, if the antibody preparation in serum already contains the immune complexes, the controls should therefore include antibody alone and antigen alone to check that neither fix complement by themselves. In the detection of the lysis of the RBCs, the lysis of the target cells, usually RBC as discussed earlier, can be followed by different methods which are listed here. So the choice can be based upon a trade-off between convenience and the desired sensitivity. Decrease in the absorbance of the cell suspension, release of hemoglobin, which again can be measured if RBCs are used, or release of another enzyme. It could be release of an introduced isotope such as 51 chromium, loss of membrane integrity, which leads to the failure to exclude dyes such as trypan blue or eosine, or failure to take up compounds such as fluorescein diacetate, which are converted to fluorescent compounds like fluorescein by intracellular enzymes. In other assays which use the complement mediated cell lysis, the antibodies specific for surface antigens on many cells can be estimated. The antigens can even be coupled to the cell surface, so the test design actually is generic in nature. The test antibody is incubated with the antigen bearing cells. Complement is added and cell lysis is measured by any of the method discussed earlier. Cell lysis occurs by classical pathway of complement activation. The degree of lysis is limited by the concentration of test antibody, as only those cells will be lysed which have antibody bound to them. A standard curve with known antibody concentration can be generated. To plot antibody concentration versus degree of cell lysis, the above test will work only with the complement activated isotype of Ig, IgM and some sub-isotypes of Ig. Other isotypes can also be detected with an additional step before complement addition. The cells incubated with test antibodies are tested with heterologous anti-Ig of the complement activating class. ओनली दीज सेल्स विल बाइंड दीज सेकेंड एंटीबॉडी मॉलिक्यूल्स विच हैड प्रीवियस इम्यूनोग्लोबुलिन. ओनली दोज विल बी लाइज्ड अपॉन एडिशन ऑफ द कॉम्प्लीमेंट. लेट अस लुक एट द जर्ने प्लेक एस्से. द कंसेप्ट डिस्कस सो फार कैन बी फर्दर एक्सटेंडेड टू एस्से फॉर बी लिम्फोसाइट्स प्रोड्यूसिंग एंटीबॉडीज स्पेसिफिक फॉर ए सेल सरफेस एंटीजन. एन एक्सेस ऑफ एंटीजन बियरिंग आरबीसीज आर मिक्सड विद द टेस्ट सैंपल ऑफ लिम्फोसाइट सस्पेंशन. द मिक्सड सस्पेंशन इज प्लेस्ड एस ए मोनोलेयर ऑन ए सरफेस. With time, lymphocytes release antibodies. The monolayer is overlaid with the complement. If the test sample of lymphocytes releases antibodies specific for the antigen bearing RBC, these antibodies bind to the antigen bearing RBCs. The subsequently added complement gets activated on such RBC only. Number of zones or plaques of lysed RBCs reflect the number of correct lymphocytes present in the test sample. A further confirmation can be obtained by adding free antigen to the lymphocyte suspension. In this case, no plaque formation confirms the specificity of the lymphocytes. Plaque forming cell assays are used to detect antibody forming cells. The assay, in fact, can be performed in three different ways. In the case of indirect plaques, cells producing antibodies to a particular antigen releases it, whence it diffuses and binds onto antigens on red cells. This may be red cell surface antigen, or the red cells may be sensitized with another antigen, as in the hemagglutination assay. To detect the IgG antibodies bound to the red cells, it is necessary to add anti-Ig antibody and then complement. Complexes formed on the cell fix complement and produce a zone of erythrocyte lysis around the B cell. In the direct plaques method, antigen-specific IgM antibodies are capable of causing complement-mediated lysis without the addition of an extra layer of anti-immunoglobulin. Thus, the numbers of antigen-specific IgM and IgG plaque-forming cells can be estimated separately. In the third variation, which is reversed plaques assay, this method measures total immunoglobulin-producing cells, not just antigen-specific cells. Released Ig binds onto red cells, sensitized with anti-Ig, this complex now fix complement and cause cell lysis. There is another technique called LC-POT assay. B cells are relatively easier to identify or estimate. These cells secrete only antibodies. T cells, on the other hand, have different classes. T cell receptors are membrane bound, whereas antibodies are secreted in large amounts. Hence, many methods which are used to characterize T cells can be easily adapted for characterizing B cells. LC-POT is one such assay. The assay is so named because it is essentially based upon ELISA principle and counts the colored spots produced in case of a positive identification. As we can see, the plate is coated with the antigen for characterizing B cells, or an antibody against the cytokine for characterizing T cells. The lymphocytes are placed on the top of this. The lymphocytes secrete the antibody in the case of B cells, or the cytokine in the case of the T cells. A second antigen or cytokine specific antibody coupled to an enzyme is added, and if the secretory product is specific to the added antigen or antibody. It binds to them at the spots near the lymphocytes, giving rise to a spot of insoluble colored precipitate if the test is positive. T lymphocytes can be detected by stimulation with the presence of antigen. In the lymphocyte stimulation test, lymphocyte separation occurs on the Ficol isopaque. The defibrinated blood is diluted and mixed with tissue culture medium and is added to Ficol. After centrifugation, RBCs and the PMNs form pellet. Lymphocytes collect at the interface of Ficol, which is the lower phase, and diluted plasma, which forms the upper layer. Lymphocyte population can be further separated from macrophages by transferring the suspension to a plastic vessel. Macrophages bind to the plastic surface, leaving the lymphocytes in suspension. Alternately, addition of iron filings lead to their uptake by phagocytes, which can now be removed by using a magnet. In this test, the lymphocytes separated as above are washed to remove any antigen. These are mixed with antigens and the culture medium. Tritium labeled thymidine is added and the cells are harvested after 16 hours to measure radioactivity. Lymphocyte, if specific to the antigen, get stimulated and start DNA synthesis, which leads to the incorporation of tritium labeled thymidine. Robin Coombe was the first one to raise Ig antibodies. To recognize him, this test, which uses such Ig to detect antibodies which cause erythroblastosis fetalis, was named after him. To recapitulate, if father is Rh positive, Rh negative mother makes antibodies against Rh antigen, which are paternally inherited. These antibodies cross placenta, they coat fetal RBC. The immune complexes thus formed are destroyed by the phagocytic cells. This causes hemolytic anemia in the fetus or the newborn infant. Rh antigens are spaced out on RBC, so anti-Rh antibodies coated RBC cannot fix the complement in vitro. In the direct Coombs test, antibodies raised against maternal Ig agglutinate maternal Ig coated RBCs. In the indirect Coombs test, the anti-Rh antibodies of the non-agglutinating kind can also be detected. In this indirect Coombs test, test serum is incubated with Rh positive RBCs. If antibody against Rh antigen is present, it binds to these Rh positive RBC. An anti-Ig added agglutinates these cells. The Coombs test can also be used to detect antibodies to drugs that cause hemolytic anemia. Let us look at another technique called immunoblotting, or also known as Western blotting. Presence of a protein in a cell lysate or any crude mixture can be detected by Western blotting. The SDS page of the cell lysate is carried out. Bands of proteins from the gel are transferred to a nitrocellulose membrane, which is more robust support. Radioisotope labeled antibody specific to the target protein is added and binds to the band, if they are present, of that protein. This general methodology will detect any combination of antibody and antigen and can be used widely. Although the denaturing effect of SDS means that the technique works most reliably with antibodies that recognize the antigen when it is denatured. Fluorescence spectroscopy and fluorescence microscopy have emerged as powerful tools in biology in general. Many immunochemical techniques exploit the sensitivity inherent in fluorescence-based methods. Before we discuss these methods, it may be useful to cover few fundamentals and information of a generic nature. Fluorescent compounds such as fluorescein, ortho-thalaldehyde, etc. can be coupled to antibodies or antigens, especially if the antigens are the protein antigens. If the need arises, more than one label can be used with different labels having different lambda max emission. For example, fluorescein is excited at 495 nm and emits at 519 nm to give yellow-green fluorescence. Rhodamine, on the other hand, is excited at 550 nm to give a red fluorescence with lambda max emission around 573 nm. The table which is shown here also gives many other fluorescent labels which have different wavelength for excitation and emission. Fluorescent proteins can be divided into 7 groups according to their color and chromophore structure. Fluorescent proteins show considerable diversity with respect to the structure of the chromophores and their colors. The various classes are shown here. Many labels can be used to view immune complex formation with various kinds of microscopes. 125 iodine labeled antibody enables visualization of the immune complex formation by autoradiography. Enzyme labeled antibodies allows visualization under an optical microscope with the help of a chromogenic substrate. Such techniques belong to the area of immunohistochemistry. Ferritin is an iron storage protein which appears as electron dense spots when viewed through an electron microscope. What we have shown here is a ferritin coupled antibody to mouse leukemia virus antigens used to demonstrate that a mouse virus carries these antigens and a cat virus does not. In the last panel, we show that these antigens may be expressed on regions of a cell membrane. Other than ferritin, hemocyanin is an oxygen transport protein from crustacean hemolymph. Latex microspheres and colloidal gold particles are other electron dense labels which can be used for labeling antibodies for studying by immunohistochemistry. Fluorescence microscopy can also be used to look at the antigen-antibody interactions. In the direct immunofluorescence, the antibody is covalently coupled to any fluorescent label discussed earlier. The antibody incubated with the cells of frozen tissue sections binds specifically to the antigen. In the indirect immunofluorescence approach, the frozen tissue section is incubated with a test antibody. The immune complex is then visualized by addition of a second layer of anti-antibody labeled with a fluorescent molecule. Flow cytometry in recent years have emerged as another powerful technique. Flow cytometry allows cell populations to be identified from the profile of the surface molecules, size, granularity, and fluorescence can be measured as cells pass through a flow cytometer in a stream of droplets. For example, cells can be labeled with different fluorescent antibodies to look at the surface density of different antigens on cells present in a given population. The cell population is carried in a sheath fluid and droplets are formed. A laser falls on the droplet which crosses the path. Detectors measure the granularity by side scatter, cell size by forward scatter, and fluorescent detectors identify cells by specific markers. In this fluorescence activated cell sorter, quantification of proportions and phenotype of each subpopulation can be carried out. Cell samples can be recovered separately for each kind. To summarize this lecture, complement fixation tests are based upon the ultimate lysis of the cells. Plaque assays based upon complement action are also available. LC-POT and lymphocyte stimulation methods are useful for identifying the cell type among lymphocytes. We also learned that the Coombs test is indispensable, very valuable in detecting the possibility of the erythroblastosis fetalis. Fluorescent labels in solutions or as a part of the histochemistry provide host of newer breed of immunochemical techniques. With this module today, we end our discussion on some key immunochemical techniques. In many of these techniques, polyclonal antibodies can be replaced by monoclonal antibodies, which makes these techniques more specific. Monoclonals, as they are called, are easy to standardize. Being more specific, they avoid artifacts. In recent years, the use of the fluorescent labels has emerged as one of the most powerful approaches in biology. Many fluorescent proteins have been engineered to tailor their properties and are commonly available to be used as labels. Thank you.